With all that is within me, and I will bless your holy name. And I will bless your all that is within me, all that is within me, Lord, I will thank you.
Boldness, I am to the holiest.
Holy are you, Lord, in all your Lord, you are faithful and true. You make all things new. Lord, you are faithful and true. You make all things new. And I will worship you. I will worship for all my days. Oh, holy are you, Lord. You are holy in all your ways. Oh, I will worship. And I will worship you, oh Lord. I will worship you alone. I will worship you alone. And I will worship you alone, and I will worship. Holy Spirit, reveal Jesus like I've never seen or known before. Holy Spirit, come and take me deeper into your realm. Holy Spirit, reveal Jesus like I've never seen or known before. Holy Spirit, come and take me deeper into your realm. Oh, come now.
Come take me deeper now, Holy Spirit.
Your anointing, your anointing, your anointing runs like all over me. Your anointing, your anointing, your anointing runs like all over me. Your anointing, your anointing, your anointing runs like all over me. Your anointing, your anointing, your anointing runs like all over me. I've never seen or known before. Holy Spirit, come and take me deeper to your realm. Holy Spirit, reveal Jesus like I've never seen or known before. Holy Spirit, come and take me deeper into your realm. Oh, where your glory, oh, the glory, glory. Holy Spirit, reveal Jesus like I've never seen or known before. Holy Spirit, come and take me deeper into your realm. Holy Spirit, reveal Jesus like I've never seen or known before. Holy Spirit, come and take me deeper into your realm. Holy Spirit, reveal Jesus like I've never seen or known before. Holy Spirit, come and take me deeper into your realm, where your glory, is under glory.
Hallelujah, 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 Jesus. Jesus, si baro moto. Zubili che ti devo rasciune nella macatera. Rosse di dermandi delle di corrascile nella mahana. Your anointing runs like oil over us, oh God. Zoli mi geto bacia nukumanje gedi gia zugole di manashina. Praise you, Lord Jesus. Praise you, Father. Praise you, Father. Praise you, Father. Shundela, shout unto the Lord with a voice of triumph. Shout unto the Lord with a voice of triumph. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We praise you, Father. Father, we are so thankful. We are so thankful, Father, for all that you have done. Lord, we are so thankful. We are so thankful, Father. We rejoice in you, O God. You are the God of our salvation. Oh, hallelujah, a God of goodness and a God of mercy. Thank you, Jesus. It's so time. I hear the Spirit of the Lord saying, rise up and take your place. Rise up and take your place. Rise up and take your place in Him. Rise up. Do not linger. Do not linger any longer. Rise up and take your place. Take your position, church. Take your position, people of God. Take your position in Him. Take your place in Him. Through Him you shall do valiantly. Through Him you shall do valiantly. Because it's not by might. It is not by power. It's by the Spirit. It's by the Spirit. God is raising up a people. God is raising up a people that will be of one heart, one mind, and one mouth, and speak and declare the things that the Father has done without any human man touching it, without anyone trying to steady the ark and bring in their own ability and their own strength and their own thoughts. God is raising up a people that will march through the land showing forth His glory. Showing forth His glory as they declare the true word of God. With no mixture. There's been mixture. And no more mixture. Oh, he's separating the mixture from the truth. You're going to see it. You're going to see it happen. And He's crying out to you. He's calling you. Come. Take your place. Take your place. Don't linger any longer. Don't linger. Take your place. It's so much more than what you've seen. It's so much more than what you've experienced. It's so much more than what you have tasted. He has set a table. And He's saying, come and take your position in your place. And through your God, He declares, you will do valiantly. Shanna, thank you, Jesus. I tell you, the cornbread and the lima beans only go so far. There's so much more than just cornbread and lima beans. You don't have to eat that every day. There is so much more in the things of the kingdom. There is so much more. We've only began to taste and see, and oh, how glorious and how wonderful what we have tasted and what we have seen. But there is so much more. There is so much more. And you have a Heavenly Father just standing there saying, come unto me. He wants to take us over into the realms of glory and the realms of His Spirit, and He wants Jesus to be revealed through us. Oh, glory to your name, Jesus, that He would call and that He would choose us. Oh, thank you, Father, but that we would count it so dear that He has. And we will step up to the occasion and to the call and not sleep, not slumber, but press in and take hold of what He's given each and every one of us. And there's some people in here that you're just starting out and you're moving and you're just beginning to move out of the thing God's given you. And there's some people here that you have lingered and you have lingered and you have lingered and you have lingered. You've stepped into portions. You've stepped into places in God. But God says it's time to come on in. It's time. Do not let or allow any of the circumstances around you to hinder you. Father knows where you're at. He knows what you've got going on. He says, step in. He'll take care of it. He'll take care of all of the things. He is more than able. He is ready to bring you in. He's just bidding you to come. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. As you take a hold of Him and will not be denied, you will see a change. You step out in the things, you step out in things in God, you step out, and it seems like the next thing you know, all kinds of things are happening and coming out against you. Because the enemy doesn't like what you're doing. I'm telling you, the call that God's got on your life, the enemy is scared to death for you to come into that place. Because you're going to wreak havoc on His kingdom. If He can convince you to back down just a little bit, anyway, if He can throw anything at you that's going to slow you down, He's going to throw it. Whatever works. And I tell you what, He knows what works. Because He's tried things on you before and they worked. But it's time to step up and say, not by might, not by power, but by the Spirit. I will run through a troop. I will leap over a wall. And through my God, I will do it all. We will not be like those 10 spies that saw the great promises of the land. The grapes are big and they're amazing, and the fruit and the land is beautiful. But how can we? When God said, go in and possess the land, I will fight for you. I will fight for you. And it's the same thing in the new covenant. Jesus finished the work. He paid it all. He did it all. It is complete. It is finished. We are in the victory. We have the victory. Him in us is victory. But we must possess these things. We must reach in to possess them and take hold of them. We look at the gifts of the Spirit and people like, oh God, I want that. I want this gift and that gift, and I would like to operate in that. And then we go to sleep. And I'm not talking about literal sleep. I'm talking about walking around asleep. And oh God, those things would be so nice. The children of Israel, when they were on this side of Jordan, they had a little bit of ways to go before they took a hold of that promised land, before they dwelled in those houses that someone else built, before they ate of those vineyards that someone else planted. There was a job of work to do. They had to be obedient to God and press in to take a hold of everything that God had promised them that was theirs, that He would fight for them, that He would send hornets ahead of them, and He would drive out the inhabitants of the land. They had to do something. They had to get up and they had to move in God. They had to move. It's time to get up and move. It's time to get up and move in God and take possession of what He's done. Take possession. Ha. You want to see people healed? You want the gift of healing? Then you start out on your knees. In fellowship with the Father. And then you get up. And you go with the direction that He gives you. And then you do what He gives you to do. You just activate. You activate. When you get on your knees and you cry out to Him and you pray and He gives you instructions, He gives you what you're to do and you go in it, you may lay your hands on people and they don't get healed. But you activated. You begin to press in and take a hold of what belonged to you. Because it belongs to you. Understand that. This belongs to us. This belongs to us. And so you just keep laying your hands on people. You just keep moving in God. You just keep telling people about Jesus. You keep commanding them to come into the kingdom. You keep going back every time you go back to your knees. You don't retreat. You go charge. You go charge up and get ready to go back and lay hold of your possession. Has He not given us the heathen for our inheritance? Did He not promise? Did He not say? He said the harvest is white. It's plenteous. But the laborers are few. There's few that will get up and fight for the lost, will fight for the souls, that will take authority over the powers of darkness that hold men captive. Take authority over the mind-blinding spirits that blind them so they cannot see. And that's in the place of prayer. You have people at work that you know don't know Jesus. You have people at school. You have people around you. You have, you know, friends. You have loved ones. Prayer will break the yoke. Somebody asked me the other day, should I tell this person that this is wrong and that's wrong and the other's wrong and they need to do this and they've got to do that and they've got to do this and that and the other? I said, absolutely not. Start out praying with them and breaking the powers of darkness off of them so they can hear about a loving Savior. Because otherwise you're just going to give them what everybody else has, a bunch of religion, a bunch of I gotta. I tell you what, when you fall in love with Him, it's not I gotta. It's that. It's this is me. This is my life. I am compelled to give it all. To walk away and give it all to Him. Oh, Jesus. Hallelujah. You don't hold on to your life and you don't care. It's not important. Oh, I tell you, though, when you walk away, God will bless you. He will bless you. And you've got to learn how to go in and take a hold of that and possess that, too. And sometimes we forget about it. We get so busy just going after it, we forget about possessing everything that God's done for us. But I tell you, when you lose your life, the things in this life, just they grow so dim. I understand that song. That the things of this life will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory. In the light, standing over in the light and getting raptured in the glory, this life will grow dim. You know, and I'm gonna just share this. You know, we didn't live here all of our life. We moved here. We were missionaries to San Diego, California. We lived on the Gulf Coast of Mississippi. And we had just purchased, you know, and a lot of you know this, but there's some people that don't. And I feel like the Lord wants me to share it. We had purchased our first home. And it was a nice home, a nice land. And we heard the call. When Pastor Mark told us before to come out to San Diego, I said, no way, there is no way I'm going to San Diego. That is the last place on this earth I want to go and raise my children. I have no desire to go to San Diego. But then when God said, we got up from our house. We packed up our things. We left an empty four-bedroom, large, and it was about 2,500 square foot home. At that point, we owed about $20,000 on that home, is all we owed on it, on over an acre of land. And the Lord had blessed us with it, but we were hungry for more. We were hungry for more. And we heard God say, go. And we packed up and we came and we lived in a garage. We had a home and it sat there empty while we lived here in a garage seeking after Him and pouring everything that we could into the kingdom. Going after it day and night. Seeking the Lord. And it's been glorious. And then the Lord moved us to Texas to work with my dad for a little bit, and the Lord blessed us. We had 1 acre and that house, and then we went to Texas. The Lord blessed us with 20 acres of land in the middle of nowhere. The nearest neighbor a mile away, my dream. And what a blessing. And God blessed us so much, we paid for that house cash as we built it from the ground up. And it was the house that David and I, you know, we saw this house and this is the look we wanted. And God blessed us with that. And then God said, it's time to go back. We got up and we left that house empty. And we came here and we moved our family into a 2-bedroom apartment. Does that make sense? It doesn't make sense in the natural. But I tell you what, the things of this world do not matter. They do not matter. The eternal riches is what matters. And I'm pressing in to possess all that God has for me. And God is calling you to possess all that He has for you. Lay up your treasures in heaven, where moth and rust does not corrupt them. They're eternal. And it's not to say that God won't bless you here, because now I'm pressing in. I'm saying, okay, Lord, it's time. It's time for that blessing to come. We've labored, we've sown, and we're going to continue, and we're going to go to the next level. But we're going to go to the next level in everything in God. In everything. And you won't go there if you just say it and don't press in to pursue it. You have to make a plan to pursue it. You have to activate and do it. You can't talk about what you want to do because then your life will go by. And if you just want a job and make money and have a house and a little family and just make it through life, if that's your vision, I would say dream. Dream bigger. Dream bigger. This life is very temporal. And the little American dream will vanish away for all eternity. Build your biggest mansion in heaven. And I'm not talking about a house. I'm talking about a position and a place in God where you went in and you possessed all that He had for you. Oh, Jesus. Jesus. How many people here could reach thousands and even millions of souls if we forgot about our plans, our temporal plans, and pressed in for the eternal plans? It's just like it was with Abraham. He calls you out to possess what you never see. the total fulfillment of, because it will come through your seed. Because when you possess it, oh, hallelujah. When you possess it for you, it's passed on and inherited by your children. And you have to take a hold of that and demand that to happen too. And not be denied. Because like I said, when you step out and you do more in God, the enemy will come out to oppose. But he is a poser. Because he cannot do anything to anyone that will stand up in the authority of the Almighty God. Amen. Knowing that God is on your side. And he will perform these things in you and through you. Oh, thank you, Jesus. He will do it. Ooh, glory. Hallelujah. I know there's a church being raised up with one heart, one mind, one passion. People that will not hold on to their own life or count their own life dear to themselves, but will have the Father's heart, the Father's passion, the Father's desire to see his kingdom come, his will be done in all of this earth. Oh, praise you, Jesus. Awaken. Awaken. And let go of you. Let go of your life. Let go of your life. Let go, let go, let go right now. The Holy Spirit is hovering. He's moving upon the face of the waters right now in this place. He's moving right now. As you are yielding it up and you're giving it all over to him and saying, here I am, Jesus. Come change me, transform me, and make me the person I didn't even know that I could be. We're conformed and transformed into his image continually as we behold him. Oh, Jesus. Sebutela. He has given us so much power. He's given us all the power of heaven, all the authority of heaven, and he just wants us to use it to activate into living out what he's called us to live out. And those of you that will take this by the Spirit, those of you that will take it by the Spirit and move, you will see a change. You'll see a change. You know, it's time to start to stop worrying about your troubles and the issues that you go through, and how am I going to get through this battle, and how am I going to do this, and how is this going to work, but to go to the Father every time, casting all your cares upon him, for he cares for you, going to your knees and saying, Father, you see, being careful for nothing, caring about nothing, being worried about nothing, being fearful about nothing, but by prayer and supplication, key word here, with thanksgiving. With thanksgiving, not coming to God pleading to him to do something that he's already done, but coming to him rejoicing, knowing that he has done it and that you are going to receive it, because it is his promise and he has done it. He has done it. Let your request be made known unto him. Let your request be made known unto God. And the peace of God, the peace of God that passes all understanding, will rule you. Not the emotions of the world, not the turmoils of the world, not the things of this life, not the cares, the riches, and the pleasures. Not you holding on to your life, but his peace that passes all understanding. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Oh, two verses up before that one says, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. This is the position. This is the attitude. This is the demeanor that we come before the Father rejoicing in what he has done. In what he has done. The finished work. And receiving it. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. There's impartation. You may think that this is another Wednesday night. Just another Wednesday night. And we're going to go to church and we're going to hear the word. And we're going to have another abiding place night without Pastor Mark. But we're just going to have another abiding place night. But I tell you what, the Spirit of the Lord is here imparting to those that will hear, those that will receive, those that will say, I am going to do something. I am not going to sit any longer. I'm not going to just go on as I have. But there, from this moment on, as the Spirit takes a hold of me like never before, as I allow myself to be conformed into his image and into his glory and into his likeness. From this moment on, there is change. Because I'm going to offer myself up through the Spirit. Because that's how Jesus did it. He didn't offer himself up by his ability, even though he was God. He offered himself up through the Spirit. And how can you do anything other than that? That's the problem. You've been counting the cost too much. You've been counting the cost, and the time has gone by so quickly as you count the cost. Jesus. No more. For those that will hear and receive and take a hold of it, no more. It's a day to live in the realms of heaven, to have heaven on earth, to have a people that walk as the heavenly people in the United States of America. It doesn't just have to be China that they're heavenly people, but we have heavenly people here in the United States of America. Where the cares and riches and pleasures of this world, the entertainment, and everything else around us pulls so hard on us, pulls so hard on God's people, so trained through society to live out your life like this, and this is what you have to do, da 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 da, that God's people aren't heavenly people like he's called us to be. He says, if you will do these things, he says, if you will do these things, it will be days of heaven on earth. It's his promise. He says in Deuteronomy chapter 11, therefore shall you lay up these words that he commanded in Deuteronomy. Oh, I tell you what, reading the word of God, how glorious. Deuteronomy is, I think, now one of my favorite books of the Bible. And I can't decide which one's my most favorite from Genesis to Revelation, but Deuteronomy's up there. Like they all are. Therefore shall ye lay up these my words in your heart and your soul and bind them for a sign upon your hand, that you may be, that they may be frontlets between your eyes. And you shall teach them to your children, speaking of them when you sit in your house and when you walk by the way and when you lie down and when you rise up. That sounds like you're talking about Jesus all day long, and you're talking about his commandments, and you're talking about what he does all day long. You're talking about what he's doing all day long. There's not time for anything else but what God's doing. And you shall write them upon your doorpost the doorposts of your house and upon your gates, that your days may be multiplied and the days of your children in the land which the Lord swore to your fathers to give them, as the days of heaven on earth, as the days of heaven on earth. The possession that your father promised you. Are you taking your possession? Are you sitting back and wondering in the wilderness for 40 years and waiting for time in your life to go by before you take the possessions that Jesus Christ paid for? And this is how Father told them to do it, to write it upon their doorpost, to put it as frontlet before their eyes, to make little things around their arms. And then he said in Jeremiah 30:33, he said, I'm going to write it on your heart. And then you look over here in Hebrews at that finished work, Hebrews chapter 8. All of this, starting with verse 6, and you can get in, going into this and looking at keeping covenant. And, you know, that's something the Lord has just been really speaking to me really loud. And I don't think you can read Deuteronomy without getting that. But the covenant that he set before us over the last couple of weeks, it's been covenant-keeping people. Are you keeping covenant? And as, you know, I've been ministering to people in counseling and stuff, I'm like, covenant-keeping. Are you a covenant-keeper? This is the covenant that he's made with us. But anyway, that's another message. But right here, he says in verse 10, for this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their mind. I will write them upon their hearts. And I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me a people. And they shall not teach every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord, for they shall all know me from the least to the greatest. Hallelujah. He's written it on our hearts, so we have so much more than what they had in the old covenant, the new covenant that he paid for with his blood, this new covenant that he gave himself for us, this new testament that he handed to us of here it is, it's finished, it's done, the work is done, now take a hold of it, it's all yours, it's freely, just receive, receive, receive. And it's not by works of righteousness that we have done, but it's according to his mercy that he saved us. It's according to his mercy. It's according to his goodness that he poured out all of heaven for us to possess and have. But will we take it? Will we receive it? Will we receive what he's done? In Timothy, he told Timothy. He said in Timothy chapter 1 Timothy chapter 6, he said, fight the good fight of faith. He said, Timothy, fight the good fight of faith. God is saying, fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, whereunto you are also called and have possessed a good profession before many witnesses. Lay hold of it. Lay hold. It's done, it's finished, but you must lay hold. He's fought all the battles, and he'll fight all your battles. He'll take you through by the Spirit, rejoicing. And again, I say rejoice. But will you possess what he's done? I just hear the Father so crying out, will we come and take a hold and possess? Or we stand back and look at the impossibilities of people, of the human ability. Ah, that's the problem. We're looking at us and not at him. Because it's not us, it's him. He's done it, but we must lay hold and possess it. But I like how he says, fight the good fight of faith. He's made us warriors. And he said in Timothy chapter 2, verse 4, 1 Timothy chapter 2, isn't that where it's at here? No, 2 Timothy, sorry. Verse 4. No man that warreth entangles himself in the affairs of this life, that he may please him who has chosen him to be a soldier. He's called us to be good soldiers. Soldiers do what they're told. Soldiers are obedient. Soldiers are up and out the door, dressed with everything done and in line, in form, the very moment they are told to be there. If not, there's big trouble. They're very trained because it could cost someone's life if they don't follow the rules. They can't have a warrior and a soldier do whatever they feel like doing when they feel like doing it. They can't have them running late and on their time and having all their excuses. Excuses will not make it in any military force. Not 2,000-3,000 years ago and not today. It doesn't work. Excuses don't work. God doesn't like them. I would hate to see anybody stand before him on that day with a bag of them. Because it isn't going to do you too good. Excuses get you nowhere. Obedience gets you everywhere. Obedience puts you out there to be a general. If you want to finish your race and run it well, you do it as he's called you to do it. And by his ability. In another place that he talks about a good soldier is Ephesians. And all of us know this. Probably most people in here, we've got a few people in here that may not have this memorized. But it's about being a good soldier again. And it starts in verse, chapter 6, verse 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. And there's the start of being a good soldier right there. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. He is your strength. He is your ability. And he is able. The power of his might. And he says, step out and pray for someone. And what happens with that, with so many people? They process it through their brain. Well, they didn't ask me to pray for him. And how did I get here? And wait a minute, I didn't pray enough. Put it all into works and put it all into your ability and process yourself right out of living in the realms of glory. And I mean, we don't have to have a whole church service in the middle of a grocery store or wherever God has us. We can just simply say, do you know Jesus loves you and he wants to touch you right now and he wants to heal you? And the Lord told me that your back has been hurting you really bad for several years. And he said, it's about right here. Can I pray for you? It's that simple that God wants us to move out. He said, go and preach the gospel. Now, how, you know, that is it laid out how God wants us to do it. He said, go and preach the gospel. And when you preach the gospel, these signs shall follow them that believe in my name, in the name of Jesus. So I wouldn't do anything outside of preaching the gospel and in the name of Jesus. And then he said he would show up and show forth his glory in us. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father God. We praise you, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Father God, for the people that you have called, Father, to do valiantly in you. We thank you, Jesus, that you are touching right now by your Spirit, Father God, every person that is willing to reach out and touch you. Every person that's willing to reach out and take a hold of you, Father, and say, Lord, tonight, there's going to be a difference. Some of you have grown and you've grown and you've gone deeper, but tonight you can go deeper because it's from glory to glory. It never ends. It never stops. You can make a commitment tonight to say, I am going over into the realms of glory and I'm not going to be stopped. I'm not going to be hindered any longer. I'm going to fight this good fight of faith. I'm going to lay hold on everything that God has for me. Tonight, no longer will I be pushed back. Thank you, Jesus, by the enemy. By the enemy. Thank you, Jesus, because greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. There are a few people in here tonight that's taken a hold of it. You feel the presence of the Lord. You feel God saying this to you. You are sitting here going, I'm taking this. I am tired of staying where I'm at. I'm taking this. In Jesus' name, I'm taking a hold of this. I want you to run up here right now. Now, I'm talking about the ones that feel that touch. You feel it on the inside of you. You're saying, Lord, this is for me. I heard it. And you've been touched. You feel that anointing. You feel that presence of the Holy Spirit. I don't want just anybody to come up. Now, I'm serious because I've been watching the Holy Spirit move here. There's some of you that are up here that you've taken it. You grabbed it by the Spirit. And the manifestation of it's going to come. There's some of you up here that you're coming up here because that's what we do. And there's some of you sitting back there that I saw God touch and you didn't get up. I saw God say it and you grabbed it and you said, yes, Lord, this is what I want. And you're still sitting there. I'd rather be up here than still sitting there when the Lord touched you. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In
Jesus' name.
Father, that will take a hold and possess, Father, those things, Father, that belong to them in the kingdom. Thank you, Jesus, for those that will go in, Father, and touch heaven and will not be denied.